I went upstairs, up the windy stairs, all filthy and dusty. There's Richard sitting in this great big old iron, you know, wrought iron double bed, big goggly Buddy Holly sort of glasses.
So Richard was sort of the catalyst that made things happen. We couldn't have done any of it without him. We absolutely couldn't.
I said, you could do with a recording studio. What about this? What about going into the country and creating a country studio?
Tom had somehow, and I don't know how, become in contact with Richard Branson, who was running a student magazine at the time, and I was taken up there, and he said, he wants I've talked him into having a recording studio.
Well, the job was exciting because they were looking for a buyer for the mail order and for the shop. Just the idea that I could come to work and listen to music all day and order records was just fantastic. I never thought much beyond that, although Richard was talking about, you know, I'm going to start a record label, I'm going to open a recording studio, I'm going to do this. But I thought it was all a bit fantastical, but, you know, might happen.
I met Richard and the student team in 1968, and that was courtesy of a friend of mine who moved to London, who knew some of the gang, and generally hung out in the Albion Street offices and with the crowd, and a lot of music was involved, and we had a very professional record export business which complemented the cheap record deals that Virgin were giving.
He'd got hold of some tape recorders and was working at home, just putting together all the little bits that he'd written over the years, only his favourite bits. So he had these little snippets of tunes, and he just razor-bladed them together into a sequence.
The staff there, it was just so many creative people. I mean, One of the so-called girls at the manor that was cleaning out the bedrooms and making the breakfasts, 20 years later, she was a director in one of the companies in EMI.
I came down the stairs one morning very early, and the sun was just coming up, and I heard this music coming out of the little snug that we used to use for recording. And I opened the door and there was this guy sitting on the floor with his little beer cord tape recorder. He was playing guitar and he was sitting there cross-legged and just playing this amazing music. And I knew this was something special from the very second I heard it. I mean, I knew it was. And, you know, Mike said to me, well, can you get Tom to, you know, have a listen?
Well, actually, I didn't actually meet him until I found myself at the Manor as a new member of Gong doing the recordings for Flying Teapot.
And then we were down at the Manor recording, I think, tracks for an album called Hoorah. And when we'd finished, we were in two or three days, and Mike was working at night with Tom, you know, all the downtime he was making Tubular Bells. And he just said, look, while you're down here, Kit's here, set up and that. Do you mind just hanging on and just doing a track on my thing, my project? You know, I said, yeah, sure, you know.
Michael came up and said, are you the manager? I said, yes, Michael. Listen to this, he said. And he poked this little reel and his face was right here. But he had these kind of slightly wild, wet eyes that looked like he'd just been crying or was about to cry. He always looked like that for many, many years. So I said, yeah, thank you. What is it? He said, it's my music. You've got to listen to it. I said, all right, Michael. I'll listen to it. Now, he said. Now. The next day, Michael, that's beautiful. That is really, really beautiful. What do you want to do? He said, I want to record it. I want to make a record. I said, I'll take it straight to Richard. When? Now?